We're here for a couple of reasons. To both promote some library resources for you, but also to sort of promote this information literacy, digital citizenship culture that we're trying to grow here at the school, and sort of address the, I guess, the issue that sort of has popped up this year about like the just Google it research style. I guess here's my question. So can somebody share with us what it means, like when a student is information literate, like what does it mean if you have information literacy skills? Good thing I asked.
Jack. My thought is that it means that they're able to sort through information that they find to determine whether a source is legitimate or reliable or not.
Yeah, that's definitely a part of it. So this whole issue with our students being able to be information literate kind of encompasses a few different skills. So it's their ability to recognize that they even have a need for information, which is, you know, happens pretty seamlessly. But then they have to be able to locate the resources that they need to answer their question, evaluate those resources to make sure that they're appropriate and can answer their question, and then sort of use that information, synthesize it, put it together, and really get themselves an answer and understand that they have in fact answered their question. So it's kind of like this really big process that we're asking our students to take on. And the best thing that we can do, and kind of going along with our theme this year of communication and consistency, is when you guys are consistent across your grade level between content areas and then vertically through the rest of the grades, having a clear message to students that there's the expectation that they're going to use the skills that they have been taught, that they're going to continue to learn those skills in a more sophisticated manner as they move up in their grades, and that you are all using like the similar language and the terminology and setting those expectations, they're going to get better. I know that within each grade there's some struggles in certain places, and we just started with the digital citizenship curriculum, but the more this goes on, they're going to get it. And it's really up to us to reinforce it and keep them going and increasing those skills, because they need them forever, really, if we think about it. Even if they're not going to college, the ability to get onto the internet and look up information for yourself out of interest is really important in making sure that you're getting the right information. So with that little spiel, I'm going to show you a couple of resources that we have for you guys to direct students to towards your research. I do want to point out, like, we're not like anti-Google, obviously. What we want to start seeing is that if the situation calls for it, and in the most cases it's going to, we want to start students researching with some of our vetted resources that we know are reliable, we know that they're age appropriate. And then when those aren't really enough, move on to Google, but have the kids Google smarter. So there's a good way to Google and an inefficient way to Google. And we'll talk a little bit more about that a little bit later. So how many of you are familiar with Main Marvel? You've at least heard of it? Have you ever gone onto the website and just looked at it? Have any of you actually used the resources on Main Marvel? Okay, so, all right. Well, here it is. So all you have to do to get there is go to maine.gov/marvel, and this is where it brings you. So this is free to all Maine residents. Anybody in the state can use it. When you are in a public library or in a school, you don't have to log in. You can just go there and you're good. If you want to access this at home, or your students want to access this at home, they just need to use like their public library card, or you can even create an account. It's really easy to log in that way. But so when you're in school and you go to Main Marvel, this is what comes up. Current seventh graders explored Main Marvel last year, so they have an idea that this exists, and they should know the basics of how to navigate through it. So if you go into kids, we have elementary K-5 resources, and we have grade 6 and up. Some of them do repeat. So obviously, fifth grade, you might want to stick around to like the top databases. Grade 6 and up, you might want to kind of float around here. So some of these databases, when you look at them, they might look scary to the kids. Some of them have probably never used a database before. There's a method to using it, and they're going to need practice. How many of you have used a database at all, any point in your life? Probably a lot, right? Because, you know, you have to use them for your college research and stuff, so at least that's good. So you should all have, like, some basic familiarity with them. What I can say probably is what you're going to want to do is just refamiliarize yourself with at least one that you feel comfortable using with your students. Explore them and explore them with your students. If you do like a sort of like learning together thing, I think that that would be powerful for them. I'm going to show you Explora for middle school very quickly.
Just, you know, we'll put out a PDF with all the stuff we talk about. I'm also recording the screen and our conversation, so that we'll push that out to you guys as well after the fact. If you want to use it with your students to reinforce some of these skills we talk about, we'll provide those resources for you.
Yes. So you don't have to remember all this that I'm telling you. All right. So I played around with a few of these different databases, and Explora was the one, or one of the ones that I felt was a little bit more user-friendly. It looks a little bit less kind of scary, especially on the front page. What I was going to do is just kind of show you. There's this basic search bar right there. What you're gonna probably want to focus on, especially with your students, is using the advanced search. Current seventh grade students were taught about Boolean operators, so using and or not, which comes into play when you use a database. So I was going to give you guys an example. I was taking 8th grade September 11th studies, and if I wanted to search for September 11th, and maybe I also want to include 9/11, because that might give me different results. Maybe I'll say or September 11th or 9/11 and terrorist attacks. So what I'm doing here is limiting my search with certain keywords. To make sure that I'm getting more of what I want. In advanced search, you have lots of options for filters to narrow your search down. I've checked that I want full text. If I wanted to, I could hit check a publication year and month, a starting one and an end one, if there's a certain year that I want my information to come from. I can choose a Lexile level, so I'll just say 7th and 8th for fun. Then I'm gonna press search. Right? So I get this whole list of results, 20,000. That's kind of a lot. Over here, you can see like what you did for your current search parameters, but you can come down here and still do more. So if there's a certain source type you want your students to use, you can click on that and it's going to narrow it down even further. There's a lot of magazine and news articles, but there's all kinds of different things, primary source documents. Some of the databases have like news reports and video and that sort of thing. So find the database that's gonna work best for you and explore it. There's some good stuff in there. It's pretty basic, right? Like at first it seems kind of like jarring, a little scary, I think, but once you get used to it, I think it's going to be useful to you. Any questions about databasing? I'm making this really basic so you guys don't have to stay here forever. All right, the other thing I want to show you is one of my favorite resources on Main Marvel, and that is Britannica Online School Edition. Anybody use Britannica? Good. So current seventh grade also has explored Britannica pretty extensively. So when you get here, you can choose the level you want to start with. We always start with middle. You can do your search right here. I always like to click in, because then once you get inside like this main area, there's all these cool things over here about exploring Britannica that you can kind of dig into. Yeah. It has a lot of information here and a lot of resources for you. And one of the great things about the databases and like and the encyclopedias on here, you can look up like your curriculum standards and see where things align. It just makes it really easy for you to connect it to your curriculum. So let's do a search for, what did I have the kids search for? Zebras. All right, so when you get here, you get your main search page. You have to make sure that you're selecting the correct entry. So I'm looking for the zebra mammal, not the zebra shark fish. So I would click on the mammal here. So this is where things get really fun, I think. So there's tabs, I'm pointing to this like you can see, there's tabs up here for images and video, for related sites, and a tab for teachers, right? So you can add, you can see the Lexile currently of your article. You've got your curriculum standards up there. So that's pretty helpful. All right. If you go into the related tab, or you can also come down here and go to related resources for this article and go to Web's Best Sites. Ta-da! This says, selected by Britannica editors for quality and age appropriateness. Wow. There's an entire list of websites where you can send your kids to do research so that they're not just getting on Google and finding whatever pops up. They're vetted, okay? And they can handle the content. That's part of the thing about the sort of random Googling. They might find like a really quality website, but they might not be able to access the information because it's written at too high of a level. This is geared for their age. And most of the articles have a decent amount of outside websites to go look at. So I tend to tell the students that encyclopedias are a great way to sort of start your research, give yourself a basis of knowledge, and then you go deeper by going to other sites and getting more information. So I really love this feature of Britannica. The other thing that's great, when you're in the article, see this little two right here? That's reading level two, that's for middle school. If your student needs a little bit of a lower level, it kind of drops it back down to the elementary article on zebras. Way less information, really to the point. If you're looking for a little bit more, you can put it up to reading level three. You get a lot more. So I think that's a great feature too, because it's you can sort of differentiate for your kids as they're going along.
I'd say remember, if you're dealing with a large body of text, remember that in this case, Britannica is saying the information that you were asking for to search is on this page, but where is it? Use the find command, Control F or Command F, and search the page for your additional keywords. It will highlight them for you on the page. And leave on the right-hand side of Chrome. I don't know if you can see it, but there are lines that tell you where on the page the words show up. You can click on any line, it'll jump to that point, scroll down the page.
You're supposed to.
I thought it did.
Well, regardless.
Sometimes it works better than others. They're all there.
Well, so if I specifically wanted, like, their habitat, hopefully that'll come up. Maybe not. Fail. Stripes. Nothing. Oh, there they are. It's right there. See, look, stripes. Ah. So.
But then this leads into the discussion that we do in digital citizenship about, so you didn't find the word. Well, maybe you can think of a synonym. Maybe they don't use that word in their description. But if you find a synonym, you have that word bank of additional tries. You can, maybe you can use those and you'll find what you're looking for.
Yes.
I'm hoping this isn't too random, but you said you can access this outside of the school.
You can.
You can.
Yes.
With a library card.
Yep, or you can create an account without a library card. Yep.
Because we work here.
Well, because you're a Maine resident.
Oh, but we don't have to put in a number or you know, give me a number for the audiobook. We don't have to do that for this.
No.
Okay.
If the students have a public library account or you have a public library account, you can log in with that at home too. Either way.
Harry, show the citation button. That's a very cool feature.
Thank you. The last feature up here. So we have all these little handy buttons up here, print, email. There's a cite button. You can select your citation style. I know in the lower grades we're doing MLA. Eighth grade, you start working on APA, right? No? Okay. High school, they work on APA. So being able to select right here, I want MLA. If you were going to do something else, you could select it. And it gives you the exact citation right there. We work on citation with students in digital citizenship, having them do it manually, find all the right information, and plug it in. But if you want to use this, okay, makes it way easier.
All right.
Any questions about Britannica? Okay, I'm going to turn it over to Nick. Oh, I'm not going to turn it over to Nick. Good thing Nick's here. All right, never mind. I'm not going to turn it over to Nick. Discovery Education. How many of you have looked at Discovery Education? Oh, a few of you. Have you been finding content on there that's useful to you?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So with Discovery Education, the question is going to be, how do I log in? Well, I will tell you how you log in. If you go into your drive, because this is the easiest way to do it, and you search for YMS subscriptions, there's a Google form. That gives you all your login information for all of our subscriptions anytime you need it. But if you're looking, if you're looking for Discovery Education, it's right here. There's your username, password, you set up your own.
Need the school code there to create your account so that you were under
our
umbrella account. But then you create your own account, and once you've got it, it's yours, and you start finding things and bookmarking it, and so that you can easily find later, reuse them.
What did you say? Go to
in your drive, if you look up, search for YMS internet subscriptions, and it's a Google form labeled YMS internet subscriptions, and there's a link to Discovery Education, there's your username there. That you use when you first log in, and then you set up your own account that way.
Is it under the
intranet? It is on the intranet as well.
Yes.
Sometimes, yeah.
On the Blue Book, yes.
It's a little bit more, it's a few more steps when you go through the Blue Book, so I showed you through your drive just to make it go faster, but it is there.
Can you share that with us? It's not coming out.
Oh. It is on the intranet. So you can get there through the intranet, /Blue Book, it is there.
So send that out. Reminder of how to get where it's located.
Don't panic, you can get there.
If you already have an account in Discovery Chase, just go to the site and say, forgot your password. Your username is probably your York email address. But if not, then we can, you can make it. If you haven't signed up, you can use that code and create your account.
So I'm only going to do this really quickly. There's a lot that you can do with Discovery Education. My suggestion to you, check out this professional development piece. There's little explanations of how you do everything, training sessions. So you can really learn how to use Discovery Education to your best advantage and get the most out of it. But really, you do a search in here. I did biomes, because I know seventh grade was just doing that. Tons of videos. There's more limiters over here. You can do source related materials, video detail. If you want closed captioning or an editable video, you can add closed captioning to some of the videos, which might be useful for some teachers with their students. You can limit by grade. So when you look up biomes, if you want this for your 6th through 8th graders, if 3rd through 5th, you were looking for something a little younger. So there's lots of ways to narrow your search down when you get this many videos. But if you look through them, you can see how long it is, the grades that it is geared towards, and it gives you a little blurb about what it's about. You can download these videos too, so that you have the access to them. It's a lot of streaming and videos, but there's lessons that go along with them too.
Yeah, some of them are tab worksheets attached, mm-hmm, and lesson plans and extending activities.
There's like a full packet for some of these.
It all depends on the
subjects.
Resources. Some have more than others.
Right. You can select exactly what portion of that video that you want. You don't have to like drag it along. So it's actually a really cool resource. I do want to say that this resource takes a lot of our tech budget, our AV budget. So I encourage you guys to get on there and look at it and see if it is going to be useful to you. It's hard for us to justify keeping a resource that no one's going to use and paying a lot of money for it. So if you could just check it out and see, and then you might find that it's super useful, and then we'll keep it around. So that's my plug for Discovery Education. Now I'm really gonna turn it over to Nick. Yeah, clap for me.
So with Carrie showing you some of the databases we have, what I'm gonna show is Google, as you said, Google's not the enemy. We can still use Google, but how do you use Google smarter? This is things that we're talking about, digital citizenship class, and the skills that they need to use those tools. So I'm gonna break it into two parts, and then look at Google, make it smart for fifth and sixth grade on the Chromebooks, and then, because what I'm gonna show you for fifth and sixth does not necessarily work for seventh and eighth grade students on their iPads, but there is a solution. There are things they can do on the iPads to still make their searches smarter. They just need to know what's there. So in a Google Doc or Google Slides, Google has built in a tool called Research. Under Tools, they go to Research. And it allows them to do searches for anything, images, search Google Scholar, quotes, they can even use a dictionary to check for vocabulary, and they simply search for what they're looking for. I used wolf as an example. What I like is you come down to a web page, there's the name of the page, the link, a description. Before they even go there, they can hit preview and see, is that a site worth going to? If they're looking at wolf, well, appliances is probably not where they want to go, so they can simply say, okay, keep moving on. Still not what we want. There's Wikipedia and so forth. There's National Geographic. If it's worth going to, they can click here and it'll open the page and go right to that website. They can do some research. All from within the Google Doc. They're using to take notes or start writing their paper, their rough draft. And they can come back. What I love is, so if this is a site that has value and they're actually going to use parts of it in their report, notice that there is an option to provide a citation for that site right into the Google Doc. Up here, if I expand this little list, you can specify what is the format that you want the citation to be. Whether MLA, APA, or Chicago. Wherever your cursor goes on the page, and they press cite, it adds a number, there's a footnote. And if they scroll down the bottom of the page, there's the footnote. I know some people, they want the kids to create a works cited page. So in digital citizenship, I saw the kids, if that's what your teacher is asking for, then once you've got the footnote, that's the citation, highlight it, copy it, and then add it to your Works Cited page. Copy and paste.
Can I be an English geek for a moment?
Sure.
MLA format does not include the HTTP, though.
It can sometimes.
It can. Not officially, but it can. Okay.
Well, once it's there, you can modify that as you need to.
Okay. It just goes at the end.
Keep it or get rid of it. But it grabs, at least it does some of the work for them.
No, that's fine. I've been teaching for 2 years, but it doesn't.
Okay, well, you're right. Like, officially, it really don't have to, but you can.
Okay. Right. So are we saying we're having them do it or not?
And that's why we're having this conversation. We need to come up with how are we going to do that here at your
house. Let's vote.
George. Oh. Did you that right now? I mean, I just said, I've watched the citation thing come up like 3 times now, and I'm like.
Keep in mind that what Carrie and I are talking about today, we're not saying this is how you should do it or how it should be done. We're just exposing you to your possibility. These are more like, in the words of the Pirates of the Caribbean, these are more like guidelines than actual rules. Okay? That's my really bad pirate impression. Okay? The research tool is available in Google Slides as well. However, and for some reason, Google does not provide the cite button in Google Slides. I don't know why. So what I just tell the students to do is, well, open up a Google Doc,
cite, grab the citation, then copy and paste it over into your slide. That's what copy and paste is there for. It's your friend. So, and we talk about how when you go up here and you use this, keywords are still important. Wolf may not be enough. You saw it took 3 or 4 entries before you found something on it. So be more specific. Now the first one is the Gray Wolf National Wildlife Federation. Ah, so adding one keyword made the search smarter. Also note that when you do searches for images, you can specify the images to be Creative Commons license, so they're free to reuse. We'll do that search for them, filter. Same thing if they do an insert image and search, it says right here, results shown are already labeled for reuse by Creative Commons license. So Google will filter those for them automatically. They don't have to. How are we so far? Good. Now, if they're not in research, they're still into a plain Google search. Whatever they search for, again, I'll use, for every item up here in the list, web, images, news, they all have this search tools button. Clicking that provides enhancements to make the searches smarter. So if it's a web search, you can specify, for example, when you want to see the results. Are they recent? You want to see results, especially if it's current events. If you do images, search tools, size, color, what type, time, do you want these filtered by usage rights? If we do news, never noticed that? Especially the news search. Do you want to see news only about the past hour? Great for doing current event work. Filter that. Now, what I'm showing you here, everything, these search tools, that all works on the iPad. They go to Safari and do a search. They will see the search tool option there. If I do Gray Wolf, over here on the right, search tools expands out. Images, you'll see search tools, color, type, time, news, search tools, can access the times, videos, search tools, durations, time, quality, closed captioned videos, and so forth. So I wish the research tool was on the iPad. Maybe it'll come someday, but there's no excuse why they can't use the advanced search tools when they just do a plain Google search. Make your searches smarter. And that's what you can do, that's what they can do, and that's what you can hold students to hold them accountable for making smarter choices when they do their searching. And like I said, digital citizenship, we talk about keywords and how having synonyms is good to have just in case, you know, habitat's not good. What's another way to say habitat? Even the order in which they write the keywords in. If you look for results, you do gray wolf habitat versus habitat gray wolf, what it changes the results they get. We look at the number of results that Google spits back. So not even changing the keywords, but changing the order can affect a search result and make it different. And then once they go to the page, I said, guys, use the find command. have it search the page for those keywords so that you don't have to read through this long page. You can actually focus in on the parts that you're looking for to try to answer those questions. And that's the way it is right now. Who knows what Google will do tomorrow or what we'll learn tomorrow to try to make our searches smarter.
Thank you.
Well, just for some of those ones on the internet, the free discovery stuff, when I was kind of playing around with that, but it asks you to have an administrator, email administrator password to access some of that stuff.
In discovery?
Yeah, rewrite. Not discovery, and some of the other ones that are there. We don't have access to all of them.
From Marvel, you mean?
No,
the subscription.
The subscriptions that Carrie told us to
keep. Oh, yes.
That they're all there, but when you go in, sometimes they say you need an administrator. The one I was in said you need an administrator.
Okay. Then contact me.
Okay.
Send me an email, and we'll get you hooked up. If I can't do it, I'll pull in this guy back there.
All right. Good.
We'll get you this.
All right. Perfect. I didn't know if there was a standard. I think you're.
If it's not, directions aren't on the spreadsheet there, then contact me.
All right.
Any other questions?
Thank you. It's because I know sometimes we lose touch and, you know, not necessarily know what's going on. Just